Hello, everybody, and welcome back once again to the Mordheim Mercenary tutorial playthrough. So, in this video, we're going to do something that I would not recommend, and that is we are going to take on the story mission today. And we're going to do that before we fill out our warband. I would suggest, if you're going through this in a normal campaign setting, it's usually better just to do regular missions until you have all of your main character slots unlocked down here, which will involve two more hero classes that you can use and one more henchman. So we are going to be missing effectively three units when we walk into this. Now, last time we did unlock a secondary hero slot, which we are going to use. Now we've already got ourselves a Youngblood. Now, some of the other options here. Here is a Warlock. Warlocks are a little tough to use. And those are the two heroes you get. So we're going to grab a Warlock. They are a interesting character to use. Definitely would not recommend it, mostly because they take a lot of money to train just by nature of being a caster. We will grab one here and add him into our team. Now, we also have the Smuggler here and the Wolf Priest. And these are both DLC characters, and they are perfectly usable. Very good characters, interesting playstyles. Nothing incredibly broken with these two. Of any particular note, this character does move one extra distance compared to most units. As you see, they use 6 movement. She has 7. And she is immune to trap effects, which is very useful if you walk into them. However, that only works so far as it doesn't affect you with the debuff. You will still stop your turn immediately, so that is tough to use. It's not tough to use. It works automatically, but it is not as strong as it sounds, as some of the traps really don't have that detrimental of an effect anyway. But what we're going to do is we're going to grab an Arcane Spellcaster. I think if you were trying to fill out early, you might be better off just to pick another Youngblood. 12 weapon skill is a little low for a melee character, but there is a third hero slot for every warband, and they unlock, I believe, at rank 5, but it may be rank 3. I don't recall completely. So let's just hire him in. You'll see our money's getting a little bit desperate here. Typically, you don't want to get casters in, especially with an early campaign like this. It's a little tough to do. Unfortunately, with him, he can use maces, which is nice. Let's take a look at his spell here. He has Blinding Light, which hits everyone. It reduces melee hit, ranged hit, dodge parry, and spell casting. It's a decent move. It's not too bad. Now, I think something that might be better in this scenario, because we're going into a story mission, a hammer hits the same. He has very low weapon skill, but as a caster, you know, what we'll want to do is get him 2 maces, is the important thing to do. For very low level, I would honestly suggest not doing a mission like this early, but we're going to try for it here. We're just going to use these 2 hammers here, because 50, and you'll see it changes it 38 to 41, but if we use a staff, 27 to 38. It's just not worth it because he has a singular spell, and we will actually go over some spell casting in the middle of this as we go. But we won't be able to truly rely on him, but I think this will be interesting, as I typically would never take a mission like this myself. If we look at the mission, and here's another thing to keep in mind as well, these story missions have a rating. Down at the bottom, you'll see it says 700. That never changes, and this mission never leaves once it's unlocked. You cannot unlock further missions in the story until you complete this one, but don't feel like you have to rush this mission, especially if you'd rather train up or unlock other character slots. This stays forever. Okay. You look at some of the other ones. These are not terrible missions. This is probably one of the most difficult starts if your team's slow. If you have a high initiative, this can sometimes be okay. Though typically randomly getting your units placed around the board is not what you want to do. So let's waste no more time here. Also, another important thing as well is it does have a flat warband rating. So this isn't important now, but it will be later. You can equip stuff in the offhands to get more warrior rating, and that will boost the numbers, and it's very useful. But that's more effective in later missions. Now, what we're also going to want to do is any melee characters here, we're going to, you know, give out a helmet to our leader, because I feel like he's going to be stuck in fighting some particular units in this story mission. Okay, let's get in there, and I will show you what happens.
Bring us to the docks. The quayside is in the possession of the Ratkin. If we are to use this area to speed transport of Wordstone to the Baron, the vermin must be exterminated. Only when the last of their foul breed has been driven from the area can we safely begin to use these docks. This will be no easy task. There is no surprising the Ratmen. Their eyes and ears are everywhere. They will be waiting for us to strike. They will have planned their ambush and laid their traps well. You must be cautious as you make your attack, but do not allow caution to make you timid. If we are to have any chance of success, speed is of the essence. The Skaven are a fractious breed, but they will rally together to destroy a common foe. Reinforcements will come swarming up from the burrows of the Ratkin if they think the quayside will be lost to them. The sewers leading to their burrows must be sealed, or there will be no victory for us here. A band of dwarf treasure hunters failed where we hoped to succeed. Fortunately, they left behind a store of blasting powder in great ironwood barrels. Find these barrels and set them at each sewer junction. We can use them to seal the openings and cut off the ratmen from their reinforcements. This must be done if we are to carry the day and make use of the quayside.
Okay, and you always get these nice little intros. This is also here. During story missions, there's certain changes. Specifically, and it is the first tooltip there, morale has no impact on the enemy warband. You can only achieve victory by completing the objectives. When an enemy is low on warriors, reinforcements will begin to arrive. Now, this is an important one. This will only start happening when they are beneath 5 units on the entire map. 5 units. And it will spawn in at a maximum of 2 at a time, and it will not spawn 2, obviously, if it'll go over 5. It will only spawn 1 in that scenario. So, in some scenarios, it is a better call to just let them keep their 5 units. Another thing to keep in mind, well, with this one, it won't matter, because they'll be spawning the weakest potential units immediately upon that. But in later missions, their quality will slowly deteriorate the more reinforcements you kill. And you can get a lot of free XP if you want to consider it that way, but I would not use this to really level up your characters. You could, but it is risky. It is Mordheim, and there's always more missions. And also in this mission, you get a special unit who will be our main fighting force with this mission. But if he were to go down, we immediately rout. So we have to keep that in mind. Now, another reason I would not suggest this mission is because typically with these missions, because there is a constant spawn of enemies, they are absolutely going to keep the pressure on you. With 5 units, that is a lot of pressure to deal with. So, beginning here, we can see that there is a caster rat here. He is an Eshin sorcerer. And we definitely need to take him out as soon as possible, but he is at a high ground. We also see there's a hero here. Skaven can move quite far, and that is something you really have to keep in mind. So when trying to gauge how far an enemy can move, you have to consider this greatly with Skaven, because they can get a lot farther than you. They have 8 movement, you have 6. 30% movement per circle is quite substantial. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to take some shots here at a 65. I have little faith of these hitting, but we're going to take them anyway because any damage here will be great. You can see he has basically maybe at best level 1 health at 114. I would say that's level 0 because they get 10% extra wounds just by being the AI. Our first shot hits, which is very nice. And we can reload and try a second shot here. Now, in this case, what I plan to do is I'm going to aim to try and guarantee some extra damage. Well, that is fantastic luck. Getting a stun already is super, super valuable. What I'm planning to do here is, even though he's stunned, and we are going to want to get up there, if anyone can get up there before his turn. At the start of a turn, if you're stunned, you stand up and you lose 2 offensive points and 2 strategy points, which is a lot of points to lose. The other main thing is when you get stunned, you get debuffed with open wounds, reducing your chance to hit with melee or range by 10%. Also, it adds 5% more injury chance after battle. The injury chance does not affect the AI. That has no bearing on them. It is only for you. However, the 10% melee and ranged hit chance is super, super valuable. That's what really makes crits deadly. I would not build your character to make crit damage higher. If you want to build it, I would go just for more raw crits, because critting once for 50% more damage is powerful. However, critting twice and reducing their chance to hit by 20% is just a little bit better, in my opinion, especially when you're dealing with boss level units. However, they do also get a lot of stun, or not stun, but crit resistance. Okay, so we're going to see if this leader can get up here, because if he can, we will cause a lot of pain to him. Well, I'm gotta be honest with you, I did not expect there to be a Skaven there. Now, he is in dodge stance.
New objectives added.
And
objectives,
here's a perfect time for that. Updated. There's a hero. You can see by his little white circle there, that is a dodge stance. If you see, and you can see it on your characters as well, not with these, but if there's a star-looking... object underneath of him, that is an ambush. Let's see here. He is at 63 health. He's going to get up soon. However, if I go up there, you would have to commit a little bit more to fight them. It's not quite what we want to do. This is a lot of Skaven here, but the nice thing is this mission is very forgiving for the mercenaries. Because there's many forms of this mission where you have to go here, and there's boats, and you put the bombs here. It's always involving bombs. There's a mission where you start up here, and you have to fight down to get to the boats, and then take them over here. There's the map is the same that you do, but where they tend to make you go is a little varied. Not too much in the later maps, but in this map, it is pretty varied, and it makes it a pretty fun map. But it is a very straightforward mission in the grand scheme of things. Also, you can see there's plenty of loot around. It'll mostly be very basic loot. However, what we need to decide here is if we want to go up there to try and attack that unit before he gets up, or wait for the Skaven to come down. Now, with what we're about to deal with, I'm actually going to go back. Taking 3 damage is unfortunate, but that has got to be the lowest roll I've ever seen. Or fall damage. Okay, and another thing, that also affects the game is your movement distance affects your charge and ambush range. So when fighting Skaven, do not expect to do an ambush out in the open. You must use your corners. If you do not, they will get the charge and you will have wasted your action points. Do not do that. If you can help it, of course. I think what we want to do here, I do not believe he will have the range with those guns. He may, but I'm going to delay the turn here and let the Skaven take their turn. Now with this unit, yeah, not going to get too much out of here. So I think I'm just going to hide him here just to be out of the way of that man being able to fire his weapon. We'll just set up a second ambush and let's see what the Skaven will do. That is an unfortunate thing that the AI does frequently where they will get stuck. So you have to keep that in mind. So he is actually going to jump down here, try to get a better angle. And he has walked into range. Now he is using weapons here. He starts with a Wither and misses it. That's lucky, but Wither is not a particularly deadly spell. It reduces your stats and that's not great. However, I believe this is mostly because the AI is trying to give you a chance to deal with these missions. They can be particularly brutal, especially early on, and there's a reason for that that we will get into. Now, unfortunately, we couldn't walk into charge or to attack normally, so we take the charge. Unfortunately, miss. But we had no better option there, so we might as well take it. I believe. And this is an important thing you can do as well. It doesn't help you much because when it's their turn, there's not any reaction to that. However, the sound of an unseen enemy is still directional. Okay, so this is an important thing to do, and I heavily recommend it, is the space bar. When you're dealing with your story unit, press spacebar opens up this lovely little menu that comes with actions, active skills, passive skills, spells, stances, and of course backpack, which is useful for all your characters. But the main thing you want to look at here is pretty much everyone's actions are the same. This is filled out. Skills and spells are the two you want to worry about. Now with this particular story character, he does not come with spells, he just gets more actions. Order is a spell you can use. I would never recommend using it on a story-based character like him. Hold ground is very decent. He has quick recovery, which is a strange one. Demoralize is interesting. He actually is probably one of the weaker characters here. Now, for story characters, what I would recommend is he has this shield on, and that's great. But the real value of a story character is they deal a lot of damage. Unfortunately, he comes with a sword and shield, which is not helpful, and follows up with a ranged weapon. So what we're going to want to do, since I've already tested for that, and it is a waste that I've done this, but now we know that he has a crossbow and a one-hander. So his damage throughput is lower, and his damage output is lower, and he's using a crossbow, which I don't find is that impressive. However, for 33 to 38 damage, we'll take it. And here's the real problem with the crossbow is its reload costs. It is very expensive. So what we're going to do is just take another shot. If we can get the damage, great. And if we have the points, I'm going to switch back. So he does about the same damage with the one-hander as he does with the crossbow. And typically an impressive, well, I call them impressive because they have a similar tool and we will go over that when we unlock them. But if they use a two-hander or dual wield, there is not a scaling up of strategy points as they swing per turn. So it is very useful to keep that in mind. Now, I could charge with him with a low chance. However, he is a level 0 hero, so it's best when you're dual wielding or a two-hander to swing for the two. Now, we miss on an 80, which is unfortunate, but that's okay. We will swing again because we are able to, and we get the second hit. There you go. This poor man kind of walked into a very ugly situation. I did not check this man's armor. I'm assuming it's cloth, but we'll see what happens. Now, with this guy, he's not going to move this turn. He's just going to take an aim here, maybe get a hit. Fantastic. Now, do not forget that he also has a blue rifle. That is why he is looking so impressive with how much damage he does. It is the weapon upgrade. Getting the next quality of weapon is a huge upgrade, and the damage throughput is so worth it.
A new round has
not in
started.
Story missions, but in regular maps, when the AI sees you get enough blue weapons, they will start bringing blue weapons. And that's when you can start looting them for their weapons, and it really does just unlock a lot of potential for you. Okay, so we see a unit somewhere. He's way down here. It doesn't appear to be moving. Now, I have no fear of that hero over there doing anything deadly, so we're going to move out here. We're going to try to take a few shots here. Our hero here is actually doing quite well this round. If he could kill him now, that would be great. On a 95, it doesn't get any better. And we are fortunate enough to get the hit here. I know 95% sounds amazing, but trust me, it is Mordheim. I have missed 4 95% chances in a single turn. It just happens. So when you're planning to take out an enemy, always plan for overkill, because you never know when the dice is not looking fondly upon you. Okay, so what we want to do here is take two swings. Take one, because we are fortunate with our damage roll. So this is something important too. I can walk up and loot him, and that's fine and good. But if you notice, that's my movement circle. What you can try to do, and I do this a lot, is just try to get the perfect distance in between. If you're in melee distance, when you do this, you can sometimes keep your movement and still check the enemy for loot. I do not know if this is intentional, but it is very valuable, and it is worth checking. So with what he has, unfortunately, the mercenaries can never use warp-block pistols. However, shields are always nice, and spears are as well. However, they are basic spears, so we're just going to leave that there for now and take the shield. Okay, and our goal is to move forward here. Now, we could climb up here. We do have two heroes down at the moment. Funny enough, I think we'd be better off. And this is another thing as well. You'll notice this is a climb point. I cannot take it. If there is a zone of control blocking the climb point, you cannot use it, enemy or friend. It does not matter. Now, here's another example of the trying to move to get that. As you can see, I just can't quite make it. Unfortunately, we're just a little bit too far out, and that's okay. Now, if I climb up here, there's an enemy here I will have to fight, and I will not have all of my resources available. So, I think our best plan here, however unfortunate, is we're just going to run to here to be out of the way, and we're just going to put him in parry states. Because if I would climb, I wouldn't have parry. I want to really keep the damage numbers as low as possible. Oops. That was an unfortunate move there. I thought I was going to climb, and that's why you should always pay attention. As you can see, he cannot climb, and that is a mistake even I make with the amount of hours I have in this game. So what we're going to do with him, because he's a henchman and he can't move very far, we're just going to put him right here. And basically, that covers any approach from that side. I'm not expecting to catch anything, but it puts him in a very safe location that we don't have to worry too much about. Now, we do know there's an enemy here, one here. And another thing, while we finish this turn off, is using the E and Q key when you're looking at this table here. We'll cycle through the turn order. This is a useful way to really check how many enemies are left. The It tells you the turn order, but you can see that the question mark movements are still there. So where we are at now, we are at 59. You can see there's one more unit, and then we have really just those two units we don't know about. But one of them has already moved, and the other one has yet to move. But then we have four unknown. So I've played this. I already know there's some units in here. But we know of these two units, and I'm assuming the other units are down in the sewers. So these are the only two we really have to worry about here. Let's check his pockets. Fighting claws are the same deal. You sadly cannot use them with...
Objectives updated.
The mercenaries. So here's what I want to do here. We're going to take this corner here. And the reason for that... Actually... The corner there would be a bad idea because he will just go around to his right, our left. If we stood right here, he would go from that corner straight across and he will just get the charge. So we do not want to do that. But we cannot set an ambush here because he will freely walk into us, making it completely irrelevant that we did it. Now... A potential is here, but I still believe the fact is the same. He could get in the way. Our best bet would actually be, this may look a little strange, is right here. We cover that distance, we cover this distance, and we're going through the door. Always use that to tell. As long as you're back far enough, this pretty much means we are safe. They're not completely safe. We could still miss our charge, but this gets him upstairs and ready to fight as we need. Now, another thing we really want to do is have a secondary character to help him. And that is what we're going to do. Because I believe he is going to fight this rat that was over there. But if he fights that rat, then this rat will see the fight and he will go to assist. So what we're going to actually do, if we use shift to look, he was last seen here. So there's a chance, maybe spot him. I guess not. However, what we want to do is kind of just set up a secondary layer here to really just stop the second rat from assisting each other so we have a one-on-one fight. Okay, so now it is time for our impressive to move. Now with the, I say impressive, let's call it what it is. He is the mission, or story unit. Unfortunately, we cannot get the black powder and keep our movement. Oh, yep, we can. And see, it's kind of worth it to just try and aim for it. Now he has
new objectives
only
added.
Four slots to carry.
Objectives updated.
And that's fine. Now, here's something we could do. I could walk into him and let him get the charge. However, I really just don't want to take the damage because it's 50% more. So we're going to move him here. And this will pretty much guarantee that the AI can't move on him because the AI will never think to go back and try to get outside of your range. They will round the corner as tightly as possible in almost every scenario. So this is just another layer of cutting off the zone. He actually chose to go fight the guy that I thought would not be in any danger, but now there is going to be a fight. And that is a beautiful ambush. 38 damage, we will take it. We are fortunate he missed the counterattack here at 72, which is quite high for the AI. So what we're going to do now is bring him in to assist. And here's another thing you can look as well. Using the Alt key, you can shift through, which we had went over. But sometimes it's good to look. If we look at this unit, at the bottom, his All Alone, Fear, and Terror, and that is on the right side for the enemy, and on the left is our information. You can see it is about the same between these two units, so they have the same leadership. But that is a 1 in 3 chance that he will... That is for Fear and Terror. We're dealing with All Alone, which is a 40%. So it's a coin flip, but there is a chance that he will just skip his next turn and will let us get free hits if he gets to see the next turn. So we're going to take our two swings on 74. Already a beautiful hit at 37. We're going to take a second one, and if this hits, which would be lucky within the math, but I consider it lucky for Mordheim standards, he will be gone. And he's already eliminated. That's just how volatile the early game is. This unit that we just hired is also using two hammers, which have a very, very good throughput of damage. They have high-end damage and not a big range of damage. However, follow up with that, they do not really bring any extra hit chance. They only bring critical hit damage. Oh, this is also another useful time to point out. If you fail a climb, you'll see my first one at the top right. I rolled a 73 out of 72 and failed, taking 9 damage. The second time, I also failed. However, you'll notice my target was 82. It went up by 10%. Now, it'll only do this once and will continue it until you pass your climb. We just weren't very lucky here. But for the little damage we took there, 17 damage is the least of my concerns. Okay, so we have this unit left. We're going to have him climb up, and he succeeds. Fantastic. Now, a fun little thing you can do here as well is we do want to grab some loot in here if we can help it, but we're not too focused on it. Story mission is way more important. There is 3 there, but I would rather pick that up on hero units and have the henchmen pick up kind of the basic stuff. Because I believe his backpack is 3. He could actually pick up all 3, but he is a ranged unit, and I find that I often don't use my ranged units to carry around stuff because they need to use their strategy points not just for movement, but for reloading, which is very critical to them. A melee unit could end his turn without strategy points and not be able to dodge or parry, but that's not as bad as being unable to reload and utilize your damage. So what we're going to do is just put him right here, put him on an overwatch, and hopefully that Skaven will come around this way and we'll walk into that. And if we hit, that'll be a free 40 damage. We could only hope to be so lucky. Now, we have taken out 3 rats, 2 of them heroes in this turn. That is a very good turn.
A new round has started.
And if you look at the round 3 here, and it says out of action warriors, they will tell you in that message if reinforcements arrived. I do not know where that rat is. He is actually standing in a very poor location. That is quite impressive. He has actually bamboozled us and gotten through the top here. I do not believe it. So there was just another rat hiding. And that's a thing with story missions. And once reinforcements start arriving, that'll be another thing we will have to discuss. Okay, so we're going to take 2 shots here, see what damage we can get. Now, he was using shurikens, which unfortunately are Skaven only. 3-2 hits. We're just going to take him out if we can. If you have the choice between 2 units to take out, one is using ranged and one is using melee, always choose melee. Ranged damage is actually quite lacking in comparison in terms of throughput. Ranged is very good when catching people with Overwatch and before the real melee fighting begins. Now, this will be interesting. And this is an effect you may not get many times, but this is perfect that we get it. Now, I'm climbing up underneath of him, and you're going to watch me explode into light. Apparently not. I always forget which way this works. And it's when you jump down on the enemy, I suppose. But when you jump down, if we did this in reverse and he was down there and I leaped down onto him, you would get a 10% bonus hit chance. It's very minimal, and there is a very cool effect. I just forgot which order. I think I've experienced it perhaps 3 times in all of my playtime, but that has gone off, mostly because trying to set it up is not really worth it. Okay, we're just going to go for 2 hits here and see what happens. Excellent hit. And a second one. And another excellent hit. That was a very good bit of damage. 54 is fantastic. Now, actually what I'm going to do here, because I think this unit is going to be dead this turn, I'm going to delay his turn so he can get moves later. Okay. And what we want to do is walk into this just perfect here. So we can go, actually, with 20 health, this is another situation where charging is not helping. Sticky Sludge is not a great pickup, but they're okay. It reduces movement. We may find a use for it. It doesn't hurt to pick it up, but if we look at the item, it takes action points to throw, and it doesn't do damage. It just slows down the enemy. Okay, so we're going to walk into this unit, and we're going to take a swing. 87%, and we are fortunate enough to hit. I'm not even going to check his pockets because I already know that the loot will not be anything substantial for what we are looking for. Okay, so he can pick up 3 barrels here, but there are more barrels in there. I believe he has 3 slots available as well, and our mission leader has 4, so that is already 7, and if he has 3, that can be the remaining barrels we need. So we do not need him to do that. We're going to just have him run towards the next objective. And just park him behind a wall, because sometimes you're not going to have the movement to do a dodge. And if you're not sure where the enemies are...
Objectives updated.
You know, it's better to be behind a corner and not give them the chance to charge, because that 50% is a lot. It is very brutal. Now, I was going to check for loot here, see if there's anything of value. And there is some up here, and we can check it. We might as well, because we're up here. Why not? This is not particularly useful, but in this current scenario, I will say take it, because you can sell it. Okay, and 32 gold crowns is a fantastic find, because we want the money. Okay. And there is some wordstone further in the mission, but not a lot, you will notice. The main source of wordstone is always this little icon on the map, because that is the enemy cart. Now, there is not a cart on story missions, but it serves as the same marker. And in story missions, looting that box will have tons of wordstone and gold in it. A ton is a over-exaggeration. However, it is true that it is in there, and that is your best source of it. There's a fragment there. I suppose we can pick it up with him on the next turn because he's right there. Okay, so his plan here. Pick up these 3.
Objectives updated.
Okay, so there's still 6 more to pick up, and those 2 will have to go upstairs to find it. Okay, and we're going to move him this way because he is prepared to go. His pack is full. And we are not quite out of the woods yet. If we actually look here, and this is why switching it around is a good idea, you'll see if we go to the start of the turn, we have this unit going first. You see they have a unit on 52, and they have 3 on 42, 34, and 24. What that means, and now we can plan for it with that knowledge, is the enemies will
Objectives
spawn
updated.
A unit
Objective
next
completed.
Okay, so here's another interesting movement technique that I would use if you can. It does come with a potential downside, but if you want to go up the stairs, you might think, well, yes, I want to go up the stairs. I will run to here and up the stairs. But if you notice, there's a movement used, and there's a movement used. That was 2 movement right there getting up the stairs. However, because of the way we're approaching this, and this isn't important, but it is a nice tech that will save you a few strategy points here and there. And the circle is always spawned based on where you touch the circle. So right here, you would think, well, now I have to spend movement here and to go up. But that is not how the game works, because it is always a movement circle, and range does not, or height rather, does not matter. I can move all the way up here on that one movement. So instead of having a movement here, and being wasted, I'm going to now put that movement right here, and I didn't even use it yet. So that is a valuable technique to pick up.
Objectives updated.
And then we can grab this item. We're going to grab one more here.
Objectives.
And now he has four barrels to throw around. And then we have our last hero who will pick up the rest of it. So we are going to move him here. You will also notice he has a substantial amount of health compared to everyone else at 187. And he takes 35% less damage. So he is quite tanky comparatively to what our units have. Ah, we do in fact have a mace on this unit, which is unfortunate for what we need to do. That is okay. We will just have a unit pick that up on his way down, and he will just carry one. Because I would rather keep the mace and running around to drop the mace here. Though useful, not necessary. Okay, let's just move up here. And we're moving on. Now, they are going to get a few turns. And then the new turn will start and they will spawn. Now, this will add a very interesting part of how story missions work. I guess I didn't have to reload. That's okay. That was a wasted turn, but for them, it is fine. When the enemy gets to spawn in, and it should show up here in a second. Oh, I'm sorry. We miscounted. The special unit that we will be dealing with is actually at the start of the turn. So they are currently at 5, so no respawn just yet. But if one more unit goes out of combat, you will see the respawns come in. Though, at this point, I think this will be a good time to talk about it because it's a little bit more effective here. But when they spawn in reinforcements, there is not a reinforcement point, there isn't a rally point. So the way the game considers this is they look at what's close and they will spawn a unit out of sight. They will not spawn the unit in front of you, except in some freak occurrences. I've had it happen once where it spawned directly in front of one of my units, but they try to keep it out of line of sight. But they can be dangerously close. If, for instance, they wanted to spawn one in the second story of that house, no one has eyes on it. So because we have no vision, we don't know that they're there, they consider that okay for spawning. So do keep that in mind. They are not always that aggressive, but it is important to keep watch for such things because they will do it and it will always catch you off guard. So our main goal now is to get into this location here. You can see these three spots are the story missions. What we are going to do is, I don't see any rats here currently. We unfortunately can't put a bomb there. And because we don't see any units spawned that are story specific will not charge you unless they see you. In a typical mission, they will always start moving their whole war band as soon as you're seen. It is not the case in a story mission. It is always kind of almost if they're packaged together in a group that they will do such things. It's rare, but it is another thing to keep in mind. So you can use this to your advantage, and we will be doing it. He is going to get a debuff, which is unfortunate, but also not that unfortunate. And we'll just park him here. Now, I do not believe his pack is full, which is fantastic. I do not believe there's any loot up here that we need to worry about. So there should be one more barrel right here. He will be our objective final completed. Barrel. And he will take a lot of time to get in there to put his barrel down for the story mission. And that is okay. Because what we really want to do, because we're taking this mission so early, I want to be certain that we take the loot out of the enemy's cart because we really need the wordstone. Okay, so a thing you can do here is you could jump down here to save movement in some scenarios, especially if you're worried about your units blocking the road. That is a way to, you know, kind of clear the way. But as you can see, he can get out of the way, so he's not blocking the road here. That is something you really want to avoid. Is if two units are particularly bunched up, they will block the road and the character won't be able to get through. Do your best not to run into that. Now, story missions have as much time as you need. Do not feel rushed with them. But try not to give up turns if you can help it. And knowing that the game only spawns in extra units at the limit of 5 is very helpful. I wish I had known that earlier myself. Updated. But we will learn that eventually. Now, I will try to cast one of these spells at some point in this turn. It is just one of those spells that is not super substantial until you pay to upgrade it. But I think we need to cast it just to show off exactly how spells work.
A new round has started.
And this story mission is not too terrifying at the moment, but I will tell you that there is one thing you never want to do in a story mission, and that's get comfortable, especially if you've not dealt with them before. They always have little tricks involved. Nothing completely unfair, but you can't disregard it. Like, here in this corner, if we peek around the corner, you'll see we just saw 2 Skaven. Now, this here is a basic unit, and this is their leader unit. Those are not the main threat. However, we will have to deal with them. Now, I know their henchman can make the distance here, and he will, as he's seen us. So what we're going to do is just set up an ambush here. Let me take a look. I could try to play this a little bit greedy, but I don't think we're going to do that. We're going to do this. We're just going to set him for an ambush, so when that henchman rounds the corner, he will be trapped. Now, he won't be able to help too much in this scenario, and that's okay. We're just going to set him here. Just end the turn. And I don't think we're missing any more loot here. We've kind of picked up everything. There are 3 pieces of loot here we could have gotten by being upstairs. But, again, you've seen kind of the quality of the loot. It is nothing too substantial. There's just 2 pieces of loot here. I do not think we want to check it. It could work. The reason I'm going to check it, even though this is, sort of silly, is, well, there's a very good reason to check it. That is a fantastic find. The Bugman's Ale is not important. Now, we're going to check this one. This is why. The gold crown stack, they will go above 100. Okay. Well, that was worth it. And he's holding the bomb, which means we'll probably have an extra turn or 2 getting him to his location, but that's fine. We're going to be taking this safely. As safely as we can. There's actually a shard over there, so what I'm going to do is have him run over and pick that up, because we are pretty desperate for any wordstone we can get our hands on, especially early on. Shards are amazing. Okay. Good. Now, he is standing out in the middle of the open. However, because of how story missions work, I know they haven't spawned reinforcements, so everything's hiding in the sewers right now. Until reinforcements are here, if there's nothing close, you have your chance. Oh, fantastic. He actually made the distance. Now, this hurts because we actually resisted the poison. That is actually really useful. This Skaven unit has those green blades. When they hit you, they attempt to poison you, which does extra damage over the turn. They're really good blades, though they are for Skaven only. Now, I am a little shocked that he made the distance, but that is exactly what I mean. He was over here, and he made that distance in one turn as a low-level leader unit. Their speed is not to be understated. Now, what I also want to do here is just show you the potential of your story mission. I will be denying our character a little bit of XP. Well, it is 1, which is not a lot. So it's not a big deal, and especially if you can get the unit off the board, do that every time. So we're just going to give him two hits here. Well, you can miss, but you'll notice I can swing a third time. Now, the funny thing is you would think everything is okay with this unit, everything makes sense, and you would get the idea that they follow the same rules, because he is a basic mercenary. He's a human, just like the rest of them. He's a man of the Empire. But when they swing, they ignore the deterioration of offensive points. Okay, that critical strike was overkill, but that's okay. So what we want to do now is check his pockets, see what he's got. Just weeping blades. Not very useful. Okay. Now, he has a full pack, but what I want to do here is we're just going to put this down just so he has space.
Objectives updated.
And we're going to move over this way. And what I'm going to do is move him actually a little bit into the center, because you'll see what that does here whenever our next unit gets a turn. Okay, so if you look at his zone of control, that basically means this Skaven can only move through here if he wants to get out. Well, get around that character. So what we're going to actually do is set an ambush here, so if he chooses to ignore him, he will walk into the ambush. I've showed you this before, but it is a strategy that is very useful just because of how the AI interacts. Most situations, you can benefit from, you know, tricking them, essentially. It may be a little underhanded, but it is a city of underhanded tactics. You should use them. They get a bonus to help with their side of things. There you go, our first shot. Now, we did miss. However, that eats his movement, so he may not get a parry or dodge stance at the end of this. He unfortunately missed, but it is a henchman, so he will miss his return. He did not. He actually hit us for 43 damage, which is a substantial amount of damage. And we did miss twice.
A new round.
Unfortunate, but
started.
He is a fresh hired unit. I'm actually surprised they're not spawning any units. That may be new information for me. It may be due to the fact that we are missing three units and they spawn based on your warband size. But when your warband's full, it is a number of five. So that's the real one that you're going to worry about, because you're not going to be dealing with the lower numbers for very long. I do not believe Reinhardt has missed a shot in this whole round. Some units will surprise you. Fantastic accuracy from this man. And this typically happens from my experience, is you will have one unit that will consistently roll well. I do not believe that is an actual fact. It's just Mordheim has its ways. Now, we can see that rat is right there, which is another henchman, which is not too difficult to deal with. This should be an interesting one. And I think the way I want to deal with this, how much health is this? He's actually wearing heavy armor, which is a little bit difficult to deal with. Well, let's just get our damage where we can. So we're going to take the charge, because it's a high chance to hit on 82. We'll take it. Now, he will be fighting alone. So, with any luck, he will be forced to flee. He can't flee. There's another situation there that prevents such a thing from happening. Now, here's exactly what I'm talking about. I could run around and down the loop, but that's going to waste more movement than it's worth. We're just going to jump down. Get out of the way. Okay. And he's ready to go. He can't really help in this fight, but that's okay. Now, he is my last unit that needs to be up here. And here's another strategy if it ever happens. Because we want to be over this building length, right here we can get some extra movement, and we really didn't sacrifice anything to do that just by wrapping around. Which just helps us immensely. I would not suggest having a unit left behind like we're doing now. And the reason for that is if units spawn in now, he is going to be by himself, which is not really what you want to be doing. However, I feel secure in it at the moment. I do not think we need to help here with this fight, because we know we have another Skaven moving in. I hope their impressive isn't coming around the corner, but we're going to try to make use of hiding here. Okay. We may anger the real trouble of this fight, but we'll see what happens. Okay, this is a fantastic hit. Unfortunately, our fresh hire is having difficulties, but again, that is just the nature of Mordheim. Okay, so what I want to do here, now I could try to shoot this Skaven right here on a 53, but sometimes it's a little bit better to try and get an angle here. Doesn't look like that can happen here, so we're not going to take that shot. I was going to go for the Skaven not fighting, but we can't get that. So is there any chance? So 58, I think we get about the same anyway, so we're going to try. We'll see what happens. Not only did we hit on a low chance, we got a crit. Not that that has any effect on what we're doing, but just interesting. Now, he did have a halberd, which is a very good weapon. I enjoy it. It's a two-handed weapon that still allows parry chance. Very useful if you want a heavy armored unit that is going to use a two-hander. Typically, I think if you use a two-hander or even dual wield, you typically want a dodge based character, but it does do the job. Okay. Now, I do not believe we can loot him. Let's actually check. So we're going to take the halberd and give him the sticky sludge, because I'm not too concerned with utilizing that. And we're trying not to have too much space taken up if he should reach the cart. Actually, you can put any item in their cart as well, so if you feel in the mood to give out things, you don't have to worry about being stuck with it, like looting Wordstone. Okay. So, let's see what this henchman does. This could get a little strange here, depending on how this goes. I do not believe we saw the impressive, so we will see. Now, you'll see his shield is very powerful. He had a 40% chance to hit us. We are getting awfully lucky with crits. Now, he does have a 60% crit chance himself. Did not see their final unit. I do not believe it spawned in any reinforcements either. Interesting. Also, another important thing, I do not believe I went over it, but when an enemy is stunned and you go to attack him, this doesn't matter which attack, either melee or ranged, you get a flat crit chance improvement. Now, for ranged attacks, you get an extra chance to hit, which is 20%. For melee, it's a guaranteed hit no matter what. So, when there is a stunned target, if you can get melee towards that target, you should. As long as you are not sacrificing a unit just to get that and out of the battle. That is not a threat here, so we could run him across, but I think we're better off not doing that. I think what we're going to do is just park him right here. Based on units left, they will have They will have three units left at this point. One of them is tucked in behind there, which is going to be particularly deadly when we deal with it. So we will be dealing with that soon. If he has dropped off all of his loot. We will have someone pick up the loot, but I think now's the time to finally show off our friend. Back here. There he is. Now you will see that very big unit is called an impressive. He has 320 health versus my 133. He does 40 to 51 damage and takes 15% less. He has 6 offensive points while we only have 5. This unit is worth 2 heroes and the well, how they like to explain it is two heroes worth. That is true until late game. Late game, heroes have a lot more potential. In most scenarios, if used correctly, but we will go over using an impressive unit because you can hire them. We just do not have the rank for it quite yet. An important thing to keep in mind as well with that particular impressive unit is that you are unable to parry them. Parries are not possible versus them or a few other impressive units. And that's when you kind of just have to get used to on a case-by-case basis. Okay, 29 gold crowns, we'll take it. We're going to loot it anyway. Now, I don't want to go too far forward because there is still one Skaven over there somewhere. Though we will have to put some bombs over here. And I do believe we have to put some back there. Now, he, of course, doesn't have any, but that's okay. We picked up more money, which basically means this mission has paid for itself. Okay, we're just going to end our turn here. Play it a little safe. Here is our unit who is carrying our final bomb. We've only put three in at the moment, which is not fantastic. But we are definitely going to have a particularly dangerous fight here soon because we have now walked into the impressive. I just hope he does not choose to go a particular way. Okay, so what we want to do is we're just going to sit right here. This fight is going to go very strange. This is probably a bad call to position him here, but we're going to try to make use of it. Okay, this unit is very, very injured, so we do not want to sacrifice him fighting into anything. In fact, we want to do that so much so that we're going to entice the enemy to fight us, because he is ambushed, and we can just put him right here. The AI will see him, and if they can reach him, they will rush for it. We're going to set up a lot of traps here. This is the best way to handle these units, is kind of let them run into your overwatches if you can help it. Now, he will. He will absolutely run into that. But he will not be able to catch anything without running into our story
hero. A new round has started.
Now, he may not show up whatsoever. Nope, there he is. An unfortunate miss, but that is okay. We are going to have to put all of our damage towards him. Oh, he in fact went for a charge. That is scary. Okay. But the nice news is that a charge actually reduces his amount of points. And this is another thing we are going to talk about in the future as well, is you'll notice he charged into me on a unit who was sitting with all of his offensive points at the ready. A very important thing to acknowledge, maybe not on this mission, but when that situation comes up, we will go over it, that I like to call sort of an action point economy comparison. Okay, so we missed one of our two shots, but that is okay. We need to get as much damage as possible. Now, first thing I want to do is see if I can sneak by him. I cannot. Now, there's another interesting fact, is you can see the fear test just happened, and I missed it, which reduces my chance to hit by 30%. Okay, our leader is in a precarious situation being scared, but I had to see if we could get by. I do not believe that this unit can help too much, but I don't have any better targets for it, so let's see if he can get involved. He will probably also fail the fear test, but we are just going to take the swing. With two maces, a 51%, we'll take the 37 damage. Okay, and with a dodge stance. Now, we cannot get a full surround, and impressive units are very, very scary. in these early moments. Now, that is most likely a trap, and we could check for that. In fact, we'll do it right now. Okay. See? It is not. It is not a trap. And again, we could walk over here and start exploring with these two while we go. However, I do not want to have another fight right now because my focus is entirely on the impressive. Now, he is your most likely unit to do the most damage to him, so we are going to go for it. Excellent hits. We got two of them. He is very low on health. However, I do believe that this impressive is going to get another turn, which is very scary. Now, with this impressive, like I said, you cannot parry, so there is no point to activate that. What I'm going to do is actually use the spell here. And you can see when I go to cast it, it says it's a 5-meter radius around the spell, and it'll hit everyone. So you can just try to aim it so it'll only hit him. If it hits our, you know, henchmen, so be it. But I want to make sure it hits him. Okay, we're going to try it. And you'll see we had an 85% chance to cast it. We succeeded. Next, it rolls. Because it succeeded, the spell went off. Then, when the spell hits, there is a spell resistance, which the AI rolled for. Now, he only had a 5%. There was a 5% chance that he would just ignore the spell. And then finally, and this is the important one, is the Zinch curse chance. This is also a divine curse chance when you are using a divine spellcaster, which he is not. Sisters of Sigmar have those, and those are the ones that it basically serves as the same. It's just thematically different. And it is different in terms of like the chance you get cursed and what the curses do. They have pretty much similar ones, but they do have a little bit different weightings on which ones you're going to get. Those curses can be very, very deadly. Ranging from you take a little bit of damage, you get blinded for a few turns, you can't cast spells for 2 to 5 turns. Your entire turn just ends immediately, or the worst one you can get is you get hit by a giant lightning bolt and you're out of the match. Well, that character's out of the match, to be more precise, which is very brutal to take. We're just going to move him over here because I still believe we can get a get away here. But what we did is we hit him with a 5% less chance to hit. Can I get a better chance here at 48? We'll take it. 68. Now, this is important, too. Shooting with a ranged attack is an extra 10% because he is a large creature. That is a downside for some of the impressives. So we're going to take aim here. Aim on a 68. And 50 damage, which is fantastic. However, he's still going to get a turn. Also, impressive units do not deal with fear and terror. They are unaffected. It's a very powerful tool to keep in mind. Also, they are a large unit, so there are some areas that they will not fit.
A new round has started.
Okay, he went and hit our leader for 44 damage. He's done it again. If he swings a third time, he will be out of combat. That is what an impressive unit can do.
Objectives updated.
Okay, we will just have to pick those up. That is kind of what happens if the AI, when you're fighting an impressive unit. That is the scary thing to do. And you can see how much damage he pulled off in a very sudden shift. That can happen. Sometimes the AI are forgiving and will spread out the damage. Sometimes they will not. You just have to roll with the punches of what the AI is looking to do that particular day. Okay. So we're going to head this way. And as you can see, they have a hero unit right there, which is scary. But we are going to have to deal with them. Okay. So what I want to do here is I do not believe he will go for him because we have a low health unit over there. And I think he can reach him. So what I'm going to do is actually just delay the turn here. Or I could do this. I think I'm going to do this because I believe he will walk right past this henchman. I do not know where our last henchman is. Oh, he is involved in the fight. Okay. So what we want to do then is... Actually, what I'm going to do is just delay his turn. I think this will still work the way I want. Okay, so we're going to delay his turn. He failed the fear test. And he missed his swing. That is okay. What I did wrong here is I kind of put them close to this unit. I should have just left our story mission unit fight. But we're trying to get rid of him pretty quickly. And we paid the price. Okay, so as you can see, there's bracers. You can see it says overwhelm. Attacks cannot be parried. That is why we didn't do it. It has a tiring effect on it that does not affect him, despite what it may look like. Okay, we're going to need to pick up those barrels. He did have another shield. Objectives. I'm just going to leave it there. Updated. If we lose the shield, that's fine. I just don't want to pick up a shield that's his, and then he doesn't have it.
New objectives added. Objective completed.
Okay. You can see it added in the mission that you have to take out the impressive. And we already did. They kind of expect you to run into it and be a little surprised. That just didn't happen. Okay. Can't really do much from here, but that's all right. We'll just set up a overwatch. Maybe he'll get the shot. I do not believe so. That seems particularly far. That was the AI getting stuck, which does happen. Okay, so what we're going to do actually is we're going to walk up and we're going to try to cast again because it does not care if they're behind a corner. There we go. And we can hit him by shooting right there. And now he's blinded. And there is what happens when you fail. You can sometimes get stunned. But that's okay. We can work around that. You have to look out for those things. They are spawning in henchmen now. So we need to start getting this mission taken care of as soon as possible. We certainly do not want to be stuck here fighting and unable to leave.
A new round has started.
And do not worry, having units go out of combat is a part of the game. We'll take this and this. Actually, we do not want the
Objective
shield.
Objective completed.
We have a lot of things to do. Actually, what I think I want to do... he only has one item, so that's fine. We'll send him down this way as well. Because we're going to have him loot the cart. Does this guy have a bomb on him? He does not, but he only has one fragment. Okay. So what we're going to do is just kind of set up an ambush here because they are definitely going to be coming from that direction. We want to hold that one. Okay. So he put up an ambush stance, which is a little bit scary. Certainly do not want to deal with that. What we can do... He does have the bomb, so what I want to do is have him run up here. If we can do it, that'd be nice to put the bomb down immediately.
Objectives updated.
Okay. Good enough. Now, I do not believe we can ambush a rat before they know what happened, so we're just going to put him right there. He is going to park it right here. Kind of catch him. We will see. We have to. Our impressive can take care of the fight. I certainly hear the Skaven coming in. But we still have 6 bombs to put down. Okay, this is where you could pillage the cart, but he has all of his bombs. If we take the time to look into it, you can see there's a lot of wordstone, but I want to put down the bombs and make sure we're approaching this mission as quickly as possible. This one takes two.
Objectives updated. Objectives
updated. There you
updated.
Go. Now, what I also want to do, depending on movement, we're actually just going to put him right here. He will loot it next turn. Unfortunate bit of damage to take there. I'm not going to cast again. So what we're going to do is just put him here. I actually have plans to take out that unit pretty quick, so I'm just going to delay his turn. And we're going to let him attempt to approach, which he will do. Now, we cannot see this Skaven here, so that is unfortunate, but we can follow up with a Overwatch shot. Okay. Oh, he is actually going to stay in that one spot. So we can actually make use of that. But we need to be quick because the Skaven are going to show up. And there they are. That is painful, but we will win this fight over the course of it. And even if we do not, it is fine. We're just trying to get through here. Actually, in this case, well, he got up from a stun, which is not very useful, so I'm just actually going to move him up to here and end his turn. Fantastic.
A new round has started.
Okay, and that was probably a waste for him to reload that, in all likeliness. Now, here's what we're talking about. There's 17 gold, which is not impressive, but there is a cluster and a shard. So we're going to pick that up with him. Now, you will take a debuff, because if you pick up multiple wordstone in one go, you're going to take the check. Okay, he can put his final barrel down.
Objectives updated.
Then we have one more barrel to put, which, trying to remember who is actually holding that there. Interesting. Okay. Okay, so what I want to do, and you'll notice he can't attack me. He should be able to ambush me, but because I'm technically hugging this wall here, he can't do anything. Now, I could swing on this. Actually, I think I will. As weird as this sounds, we're going to take the swing here. Now, he will hit me back. That's just going to happen. I already know it. But the reason for that is now there is no more points left. We can bring our story mission unit up close and there will be no real concern. We should be able to get him stuck in a very poor fight. What do you have? He has not a whole lot. Yeah, we're just going to try and send him. Actually, he's not going to be able to utilize too much. Do you have more? Is not. So at best, he can pick up a shard. Yeah, let's not. As nice as it is, and they are important, we are unfortunately down a man, and we need to not waste too much time. Let's just get our fights done and dealt with, because if the rats plug up that one hallway that we're currently fighting in, we won't be able to put in the bomb, which is exactly what I mean. So we might not even be able to get around him, so we will have to see. What I'm going to do is we're going to have him loot these three, and then he is actually going to pick up their idol because of the buff you get. That will give him move speed, which is exactly what we want right now. Fantastic. So, we have the buff, which means we can move plus three, which is fantastic. That is more movement than a Skaven. And instead of charging, we're just going to go the whole way up, and we're going to start swinging. I have to keep an eye out because I do not recall who has my final item. That is an unfortunate miss, but we can take care of that. Because he should be able to go around here and get a hit. Fantastic. Okay, so that unit is removed. Do you have a bomb still? He does. If it is possible, what we can do here, because we want to leave, we actually cannot. So we're going to have to fight our way through, but unfortunately that unit's going to be fighting on his own. And I do not want to risk him for no particular reason. We're just going to aim our magic to here. There you go, another successful cast. And are we punished? We are not. How lucky. Okay. And then he can end his turn right here. We have one more turn in store to get out of here as long as we can get them through that location. Okay. So we don't really have a good angle here. I'm going to shoot on this one because this Skaven is in light armor and he's the one actually blocking us from getting through. Fantastic. Now, he had already taken his turn, so that means he is stunned when we have a lot of melee coming up. Now, he unfortunately got a hit. The 5%'s not a big deal as far as hit reduction. As long as another rat does not plug up the one spot we have, we should be able to get there. It does appear that he is up there. I'm just hoping that the henchman cannot make the distance so we can end this mission.
A new round has started.
Okay. So we've grabbed everything out of their cart. What we want to do is go up here and 81. Another beautiful crit. That is very fortunate for us. We're just going to reload, try to go for another. 17 damage unfortunately keeps him up. The only problem that can happen here is if he goes next, and he did not, but if he were to take his turn, there was a chance that he would get scared. I do not believe he can flee because he's effectively stuck into the wall there that he couldn't flee. But I would rather him be unable to flee, and what happens is he just gives up all of his movement and you have to end the turn with a dodge. Okay, so we're going to walk up. This is a guaranteed hit. Ignore the 89%. Yeah. Fantastic, and he is removed from the match, and that is one extra XP. We will actually take a sword because we're pretty much done here. Yeah, there you go. We'll just get him out of the way. He can take a swing. If he misses, that is fine. He has done his job. We are just kind of waiting to get in. Now, what I want to do, because I do not know there is one Skaven that can get in the way at this point. So what I really want to do is just kind of set him up as an ambush. So if any Skaven attempt to approach and block our turn in point, they will be unable. So we can complete the mission. Also keeping in mind of our own zone of control. Now, I do not expect him to win the fight he gets into. We just need it clogged up so no one can get in the way, so we solve the mission. Okay, and what we'll do here, we'll just take some swings. If we can get him down, fantastic. Now, this is an interesting one, but I believe his command is too high-costed, or order, as it were. Okay, I'm going to be greedy here. You know what? Yes, yes, because this is how you can be greedy. Now, these story mission units are very powerful. However, they level up automatically between story missions. Them taking an enemy out of combat denies you one experience. This man is about to take his turn, and he has effectively zero at this point. So what I'm going to attempt to do, and right there, if we put the barrel, we're done. But what I want to try is see if he can get one final hit. And he did. That is one free experience for us. We're going to see the loot. Maybe he has something useful. We will take the sword. And we will turn in this bomb. And that will be the end of the mission. we got an achievement for looting 25 search points. Or it's a loot point, but we searched 25 loot points. And when we exit, that is it. The mission is complete. That is a story mission. We did have one unfortunate unit go out of combat. It is unfortunately the nature of it. He did choose to attack the same unit 3 times. And as you can see, even if that hero was at full health, I think that was pretty close. I believe he did 44 damage 3 times, which was 132. So I think he might have lived with 1 health if he had been untouched throughout the whole mission.
Did you hear that explosion? Do you see the plume of smoke rising into the sky?
Completed.
Do you smell the stink of gunpowder on the wind? That is victory, my friend. That is what triumph is. The sewers are closed, and it will take considerable effort for the Ratkin to open them again. Let us pray to Sigmar that the foul beasts lack the unity of purpose to mount such an effort. The first barge is ready to be loaded. Using the River Stir, we will be able to speed the Wordstone you secured to Beckhaven faster and more safely than the overland route. Baron von Leitdorfer will gain a great advantage over his rivals as his supplies of Wordstone expand. The Baron is an indulgent patron. As his fortune and position grow, he will not forget the servants who made such an achievement possible. The Baron will send some token of reward in gratitude for the service you have performed this day. Continue to scour the ruins for more Wordstone. Every shard you recover not only helps the Baron, but diminishes the fortunes of his enemies and rivals. When I have word from Baron von Leitdorfer, I will let you know.
Okay, and here's an important one. And there was the unit that went out of combat. Now, when this happens, okay, they, at the end of the mission, will roll to see what happens to them. This can be a range of things. They can get a mangled hand, they can lose an eye, they can get a grievous wound, and these all do different things. They could take 1 intelligence point. They could make them that they're unable to use ranged weapons or even cast spells. They can lose a leg and lose a movement speed, and that's pretty much all that does, but it is a pretty debilitating one. You could lose an entire arm, which is very debilitating. Hands can get mangled. There's a lot of injuries. Full recovery is one of them, and I believe with story missions, this is a higher chance still. I also believe that another thing you want to worry about, this one is true. If you get crit during a mission and you have the open wound effect, that 5%, those are chances to roll extra injuries because you are always guaranteed 1, but open wounds add the chance to get a worse injury or roll double. Luckily, we get a full recovery, and a full recovery means they don't have any downtime. Usually after
nice
an injury,
progress.
They are stuck, you know, healing that injury. But we can ignore it this time. So you can see with our experience at the end, you get 6 per unit, which is very good. It is actually worse experience than a typical mission that you get the secondary objective done. It's an interesting thing. I'm sorry, you only get 5 points. In a normal mission, you get 6. You get 5 here, he just put an enemy out of action.
Nice progress.
Okay, now we're getting some units to level 2. Most valuable warrior. He actually put 2. He did very well this mission. It always, you know, varies who's deciding to hit all their attacks that turn.
Fantastic.
Okay. Another unit.
Remarkable. Fantastic.
He got, in fact, 8 experience. That was not my intention for him to take 3 of the out-of-action strikes, but he did get them, and we will take that because having your low experience or low-level units get the XP so they can get caught up is way better than having one unit way further ahead of everyone else. Okay, and you get 5 XP for the victory, which is good. Okay, and as you can see, we're only paying 38 gold. And if you recall, we looted much more than that. So this mission actually ended with us gaining money. And that is before they send you money for succeeding in the mission. Okay, let's put our points in here. We will go weapon skill and toughness, as always, for our melee character. He is also at 9 toughness, so now I will start pushing him to 9 toughness because of a skill he can get, which is under passive, which is armor proficiency. You want 12. We will probably push straight through to 12 to get this maxed, but getting that maxed makes heavy armor pretty much removed downside. Now, you are paying a lot to do it, but you also get 5% more armor absorption, which is very useful. And to follow up with that, we needed 9 toughness to get the first rank of resilient, which increases your critical hit resistance by 10. That is a lot. It doesn't sound impressive, but it really, really is. With 9 toughness and this ability, you reduce crits by 19%, which for most characters will not have anywhere close to that. Most of my characters end up, you know, around the 12% chance versus their toughness, while he will have the 19. It is very useful. The undead have a similar ability that is quicker to get and has less commitment. It is a very strong ability. Do not sleep on resilient. It's very useful in protecting you from light wounds. If your character gets an open wound and leaves the mission, he will have to have that wound treated, which will take him out for 1 mission. It says 2, but it technically means the end of that mission, so it's just 1 mission that will be out. So open wounds, getting crit, even if they do not go down or get stunned, you're still out for the next mission, which is always an unfortunate thing to deal with. Okay, let's keep the points going. This man is ranged. We're going to keep the alertness so he can keep being earlier on the turn. We're going to go toughness, I think up to level 9, and then I'm going to go some strength. I'm not too worried about agility because he should not be in melee combat very often if I utilize it correctly. Okay, this man is weapon skill. You can usually tell. Some warbands don't have it, but if your warband has someone who's dedicated to range and one who's dedicated to melee, they have a distinct look, so it's pretty easy to quickly tell who you're looking at and what point you want to put it. Okay, leadership is still very good because we are still dealing with a very low chance to resist fear and terror. Okay, he's ranged. And a thing to keep in mind is he still does have this blue handgun. That is why he's doing so well for us, and why we're getting so much extra damage. Next, we have this unit who just got to that level. He's going to be able to carry an extra loot, which is fantastic. We're going to go for leadership. Leadership is just so valuable for the fear and terror check. And the morale value is nice. We just never want to have to utilize that part of it. Now, when you have a caster, it also helps to do this. Go into their spells and click on this and look at what they have. Now, for him, your best ones are not damage. I know that Fireball seems very enticing. However, it's rare you get a good AoE to use. Lightning Strike is pretty good because it's just raw damage. That one could be utilized. But for this particular caster, the two you probably want to look at is Curse of Rust, a very powerful spell that can reduce armor absorption by 40% when it's maxed. That is stronger than it appears. Hitting an enemy with this that is in heavy armor will completely negate the heavy armor, even of the top quality. I think it leaves them with 5% left over. If they have the improved version, it's 10%. It's a very powerful ability at covering that. Armor of Lead is an interesting one. I would not go for it. Honestly, your best 3 would just max out Blinding Light for the 10% penalty, which is nice. Not the best thing in the world. Curse of Rust is good if you fight enemies. Curse of Rust is good even for non-heavy armor targets. Light armor of the best quality, it still works. It's really good if you can land it on boss level units or impressives, because it'll completely remove their armor, meaning every other hit will do full damage. And for the low cost of only 2 offensive points, I heavily recommend it. If you want another spell, Dispel is an interesting one, though, again, would not go for that. Lightning Strike, if you want to do damage safely from a distance. It does cost 3, which is unfortunate, but it's worth it. That is an interesting spell, but I would not recommend it. Effectively, your best defaults to do, in my opinion, is if your character comes with a buff for your team, maximize that first. 1 damage dealing spell just for spot removal, because spells just pretty much ignore armor, which is very useful. And in this guy's case, and you have to look at this per warband and what casters you have, but for him, Curse of Rust. Okay, moving on. Now, with that in mind as well, with Lightning Strike, you want to max intelligence as much as you can. If you're only going Curse of Rust and Blinding Light, just get enough to train them and go no further, because all the intelligence does is increases your magic damage, which will only affect Lightning Strike. But we will be trying it out, so I will level it up. Now, a spellcaster typically does not end up in heavy armor, so agility is not a bad call, and then toughness. Mostly with casters, I would say almost make them ranged, especially with him being weapon skill of 9 maximum. That is a very, very low amount, which means his chance to hit later in the campaign will be very, very low. Okay, so we'll put a point here into agility. And there you go. That was a successful story mission. Now, the other thing we did get was some light armor. And what I think I'm going to do is, he is a very tanky unit, so we're going to give him the blue light armor, which will give him a 20% damage reduction, which is fantastic because we don't want to dodge with him. So take the armor where you can get it. I also like to utilize light armor on any archer units because they're not going to dodge often in the first place. So if they get hit, we want him to take less damage. Do not believe we got too much here. This was worth 10 gold coins. This one gives you 20 initiative for 2 turns. I'm not a big fan of it. We're going to sell it for the money. Mandrake roots are okay. Okay, so we didn't get too much, but that was nice to get the extra 10 gold. And we are still looking pretty good. We have 123, which means we have enough wordstone to make our payment at 75. We could even turn some into some of these other options just to get some extra money if we're in dire need of it, which may happen yet, depending. We will see what happens, but we'll go to the next day and see what happens. Well, actually, here's one more note for everybody. If you look at some of these passive abilities or active that are under these trees here for the specific warbands, if you want to train them, they are always 1 day for the first. So, say I want Sniper Shot. Before you hit end day, choose to train it. And then the second you hit end day, they technically train it overnight, and it is done. It's very useful. For this case, there's not too much here that we like. Flawless positioning is actually okay if you have the alertness. Critical hit resistance only being 5% is a little low, but I would probably say if you're not sure what to give your characters, flawless positioning could be okay. It's a little bit weaker than the Undead's version, but it is okay. And it uses alertness. I forget. I think the Undead uses toughness, which you're probably going to go anyway. So that's okay. Combat expertise is an interesting one if you have a heavy armor unit, which gets them involved in a big fight. But that is going to be it here. We're going to hit end day because we do not want to spend the money. We only have 400. Do not spend it when you're that low. Okay, fantastic. Well, we managed to do the story mission, and I cannot stress enough, do not take on story missions before you have a full warband. It's usually not worth it. You're also depriving 3 units of story XP. Not that it's better than normal missions, but it's a lot of risk that you don't need to take. If your warband's vastly above the story missions rating that they suggest, it doesn't matter. It's still a better call just for the fact of safety. But hopefully you guys enjoyed the video today, and that is going to be it for tonight. So we will continue on doing some different missions, and hopefully we'll catch you in the next video.